everybody. That's what we came to do, right? Okay, everybody, on your feet so we can praise the Lord.
It said praise and worship. So we just praised him with the fruit of our lips. We praised him with the fruit of our hands. Some of us, we praise him with a dance step. Let all things that have breath praise ye the Lord. Now it's time to worship him. It's time to worship him. It's time to worship. It's time to go before him, the throne of grace, right now. Get that one thing on your mind, on your heart right now that you really need God to do for you. It could be healing in your body, healing in your finances. It could be saving a loved one, healing in your relationships, healing in your business attire, affairs, right on your job, peace on your job, peace between your coworkers, whatever it is. Now it's time to go before the throne of grace right now. So let's go before the throne of grace right now and commission God into helping us on what we need right now. Dear Heavenly Father, right now we thank you. We thank you, Father, right now. God, we are proud to say, Abba, Father, because of the relationship that we have with you through your Son, Christ Jesus. We thank you, Father, for sending your Son down here on earth to redeem us back to you, Father, right now, that we may escape death and hell, that we may conquer and have victory over the grave, because the grave don't have victory when we're in you. We thank you, Father, right now. Have your way in our lives. Have your way in this service on today, Father, right now, God. Oh, Father, fill this temple with your train of glory right now. Ha! Oh, glory. Hallelujah. Fill this temple with your train, God. Oh, Father, we thank you for your healing virtue. Ah, Jehovah Jireh, we need you. Jehovah Shalom, we need you. Jehovah Sikkenu, we need you. Jesus, we need you right now. This very day, this very hour, this very minute, this very second right now. Ah, bless your people all over. Oh, Father, allow us to understand what you mean when you said, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. Oh, Father, that's what we're here for, to seek ye first your kingdom so we may live like you ordered us to live here on earth as it is in heaven. And you've given us this day our daily bread right now. And you delivering us from all sorts of evil and delivering us from the hands of the enemy. And we thank you and we praise you right now, Father. We thank you and we praise you. 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 These are many blessings we pray in your precious Son Jesus' name. Amen. Father, bless your word on today, God. Bless your speaker on today, God. Bless the angel of this house, Father, his family, Father, your people, Father, right now. Bless the praise team. Bless the musicians right now. We thank you, Father. As the praises go up, we thank you that you're sending your blessings down right now, Father. Have your way in our life. Father, save that sin-sick soul right now. Anybody that's viewing that needs you right now, Father, go into that internet world right now, Father, and touch them right now. Have your way. Have your way. Have your way. Have your way. And we thank you and we praise you. These have been the blessings we pray in your precious Son, Jesus' name. Amen. Amen and amen. Glory, glory, glory. Our scripture reading will be coming from 3 John, chapter 1, starting at verse 2, King James Version. Real quick, because we about to get to it. We ain't got to read about eight scriptures. Just hit one powerful one and let's go. Beloved. That means he love you. We are beloved. I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth. That's it. Right now, we about to enjoy and join in with the praise team. So as the praises go up, the blessings come down. And immediately following the praise team, our very fine pastor will come up, and everything is in his hand. And the children, when the pastor get up, y'all may be leaving to go to children's church. I may say y'all be left, but y'all can leave and go to children's church. So now it's time to join in the praise team.
Amen. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He is worthy to be praised, saints. When we slow it down like that, we go, ooh, ooh. If it sounds good to me, I know it sounds good. Ooh. Thank you, Jesus. And now we're going to praise him. Y'all ready? All right.
many came to give God his praise today? Don't play with it. How many came to give God his praise today? Well, this is a day that was not promised. Amen. You didn't know if you were going to be here or not. This is a blessed day from the Lord. Amen. God bless you. May heaven smile upon you as our children depart to children's church. Truly, we thank the Lord for yet another day. Another day to lift our hands, stomp our feet, do our dance, and give him his praise. Amen. God bless you. And while you're standing right now, knowing how good it is and how pleasant it is for brethren to come into the house and to dwell together and to praise the name of the Lord, let's go to his throne right now. Amen. Whatever you have need of, amen. I heard Minister Darrell Fountain say a little earlier, bring that thing to your mind. I believe there's something that's on all of our hearts today that God is dealing with us individually as well as collectively. So whatever that individual prayer request is that you have for the Lord, just bring it to the forefront of your mind right now. And let's trust God to do what he promised us he would do. Let's pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we come to you once again, knowing that not only are you able, but you desire to bless your people. We thank you, O God, for the manifold blessings that you have already bestowed upon each one of us. Help us to operate in a spirit of gratitude. Help us to send up our supplications and intercessions and petitions to you with a spirit and a thankful heart. So now, Lord, as we prepare to go forward on this communion Sunday, I ask you to charge this atmosphere with, amen, appreciation. We thank you so much for what you've already done. And now as we prepare to go forward in your service, we pray that you would take full control of this atmosphere afresh. Touch every heart, God, right now. Every individual who's believing you to do what only you can do. And we give you all of the honor, all of the glory, and all of the praise. And it's in the name of Jesus that we pray. And it is so. Amen. Amen. And amen. God bless you. You may be seated in the presence of our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. Good morning to each and every one of you, those who are here, those who are viewing this live stream, and even if you view it later on YouTube, we thank God for you. This is a communion day, a day where we pause and we reflect all over again the importance of what Jesus the Christ has already done for each one of us. He's not coming to do it. He's already done it. And we are here to just say, Lord, we thank you for doing what only you could do. So as we continue on in our service and when we get to the communion time, if you're viewing this live stream and you desire to commune with us, you could not make it here in person, we ask that you would gather up waters or juices, bread, crackers, whatever you will take as we commune, and we'll pray over those sacraments, and we can still be on one accord, thanking the Lord for his body and the blood that he shed for us. Amen. Once again, it's good to know Jesus all by myself. That was just a test. That was just a test. That was just a test. It's good to know the Lord. Amen. Amen. Let's go into the word of the Lord. Thank you, Brother John. I hear you over there. Amen. Let's go ahead and get into the word of the Lord. Amen. We just want to talk to you. I know we say that a lot of times. Today, it is my heart desire to just talk to you from a specific topic here today. Share a few things with you. Let's go into the word of the Lord. Let's go into Matthew chapter 6, verses 16 through 18. Matthew chapter 6, verses 16 through 18. And then Isaiah chapter 58, the first half of verse number 3. We will be reading these scriptures from the NASB translation. Amen. If you're ready to read the word of the Lord, let's show a sign by standing as we open up these scriptures today as we reverence the reading of the word of the Lord. Matthew 6:16 says this, whenever you fast, do not put on a gloomy face as the hypocrites do. For they neglect their appearance so that they will be noticed by men when they are fasting. Truly I say to you, they have their reward in full. But you, when you fast, anoint your head and wash your face, so that your fasting will not be noticed by men, but by your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. Isaiah 58, verse 3, the first half. Why have we fasted and you do not see? Why have we humbled ourselves and you do not notice? May the Lord bless the reading and the hearing of his holy word. While you're standing, let's pray our corporate prayer. And for those of you who are viewing, please join in with us and just say, Lord Jesus, please prepare my ears to hear your word. Prepare my heart to receive your word. Prepare my eyes to see that your word is alive. And prepare my body to be your temple for the living word. Amen. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated in the presence of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. We want to talk to you from one word today. I want to talk to you about fasting. I want to talk to you about fasting. And I want to share a few things with you that the Lord has put on my heart, because fasting can just become another one of those things that we say, oh, are you fasting? Well, I didn't eat anything yet today, so I'll just fast. That's not the type of fast that God means when he says prepare to fast. And as we understand what fasting really is, we can get some insights into why it is important to God for his people to fast. So what is fasting? What is fasting? Josh, let's put up a couple of these first few slides with the definitions here. What is fasting? Fasting is abstaining from eating for a period of time. Could be eating and or drinking, but it is abstaining from eating and or drinking for a period of time. That's the general definition of fasting. But what is spiritual fasting? Spiritual fasting is an outward expression of an inward commitment to pursue God. Christian fasting is always combined with prayer. Fasting and prayer. And the final bullet, I want to let you know that fasting without prayer is just going on a diet. Yeah, everybody heard about intermittent fasting, right? That's a thing now that you see a lot about intermittent fasting. If you don't have prayer, if you have not prepared yourself to humble your spirit before the mighty hand of God, if you have not prayed and asked God, first of all, to forgive you for anything that might be causing a hindrance within your life before you start asking and crying out to God for different things, then God is saying, this is not the type of fast that I want. So as we look at why do people fast, what are the reasons for fasting? Well, sometimes we have different goals for when we fast. Well, some reasons we might engage in the spiritual discipline in order to confront sin. Maybe some things that, you know, you ever heard anybody say, I just got the can't help it. I can't shake this thing. Amen. And if there's a child of God who feels that you are still giving in to wrongdoings, then you need to turn over your plate, find your prayer closet, and go to God and ask him for the spiritual strength to get victory over that stronghold that continues to hang on in your life. Another reason for fasting is sometimes we might fast to pray for a loved one that we want to see God save. So now we step outside of our own little personal needs, but we show forth that we are concerned about our brothers, our sister, our mother, father, uncle, aunt, cousin, work associate, whoever it might be, somebody that's in your life that the Holy Spirit has touched you and said, pray for them to be saved. We might also pray for spiritual growth. Anybody here want to grow a little bit higher than where you are right now? If you want to grow higher in God, and amen, know that you are a child of God without limits, that there is nothing that our God would not do for us. It means we have to have a connection with God. How do we establish the connection with God? We have to let the flesh know that it does not control us. So the spiritual aspect of turning over our plate and going hungry for a little period of time just reminds us that God is the one who provides what we are seeking for. We want to eat, and we know God has already provided for us, but for the spiritual aspects of what we are going to be seeking God for, we're saying, Father, we want you more than we want this. And because we want you more than we want this, we are allowing ourselves to suffer a little bit of inconvenience just to let you know that the flesh does not control us. Now, Jesus fasted. Why did Jesus fast? He was already God. He already knew the end before the beginning. Why did Jesus fast? Why did Jesus talk to the Father while he was operating in this earthly tabernacle here, while he was walking the earth? He said, I always do what my Father tell me to do. The Bible said when things were happening in Jesus' life, he would go up apart all by himself. Sometimes he'd go up in the mountain. Sometimes he'd find another place to go. But he would say, let me go and pray and talk to God. And then, amen, we know at the very beginning of his ministry, he fasted for 40 days and 40 nights. And the devil came to him while he thought he was weak. Don't be surprised now when you're fasting that there are going to be some things that are going to come after you. Because sometimes people are immature in their understanding about what fasting is. Satan sees you when you're saying, God, I want to get stronger. I want to go higher. So when you turn over that plate and you make it up in your mind that I'm not eating nothing today, what happens when you go to work? Very day, somebody brought in the best cake you ever smelled. They decided we're going to have a surprise luncheon and we want everybody to participate. Now you are standing here. The Bible tells us, you know, when you're fasting, don't go around telling everybody that I'm fasting. Fast in secret. Sometimes you got to let people know, I just can't eat today. And if they insist on asking you why, tell them about how good God is and what you're doing to grow higher. But do it in a way that's not puffing you up. See, there's one thing about people when they want others to think that they have reached the state of super saint. I'm going to tell you, I fast 5 times a day. What did the Pharisees say? I thank God I'm not like that tax collector over there. I fast 2 times a day. To them, that was great. I give all of the tithes. In fact, I even give more than I'm obligated to give. Why was he saying that? Jesus said, I'm going to tell you something. You have already got your reward because, amen, you want men to put you on a pedestal, and if you feel good about doing that, you just got your reward. But when you do it in
secret. Let God reward you. Let God look at your heart. Let God say, you are doing this for the right reasons. And because I have peeked into your heart, I know that I can trust and bless you, because you are not looking at stuff and folks more than you are looking at me. We should never fast to try to pressure God into doing our will, but rather to ensure that we are doing God's will. Anybody tried to make God obligated to you? Lord, I just fasted, and you got my request. Now I'm just going to sit down because I know I got what I asked for. God said, wait a minute. When you come to talk to me, you're supposed to be seeking direction and instruction from me. What you're asking for, I love you too much to give it to you. Because what you're asking for is going to harm you, and you can't even see it because you're not operating in the spirit. Turn the plate over. Come talk to me. Seek my face. Seek my perfect will for your life. Don't just go out there and do everything that comes to your first mind. People have gotten in trouble all throughout the Bible by just doing what they thought was right. Didn't pray, didn't ask God nothing. And then when it becomes a shipwreck, God, get me out of this. I'm your child. God says, seek my face, seek my will before you take steps. Then you will know. Then you will understand that I will never leave you, nor will I forsake you, because you belong to me and you trust me to lead you where you need to go. What type of fast are they? We're going to skip through a lot of this. Now, if we were in Bible study, we would have more time to break this down. But what type of spiritual fast are they? There are different types. One type of fast is called an absolute fast. In an absolute fast, you don't consume any food or water for that specific time frame. When I learned to fast and first started fasting, I started with the absolute fast. So now when I fast, and somebody said, well, you can do this type of fast, I don't feel like I can do that now, because now I feel like I'm cheating. So there are different types of fast. See, I want you to understand, well, I'm going to tell you about the different types of fast, but it's not about the type of fast. It's about the reason for the fast. Some people have physical things that you have to deal with, and you can't go all day without water. You got to do something. You got to take medicine. God knows that fasting is not designed to make you sick. Fasting is designed to make you well. Stay with me here. So an absolute fast, you don't consume any food or water for whatever that period of time is that you set aside for God. There's something that's called a complete fast. You got absolute, then you have complete fast. Complete fast is a Christian water-only fast. You don't eat any food, but you can drink water. Then there's a fast that's called liquid fast. Well, preacher, I thought you just said I could drink water under complete fast. Yeah, but under the liquid fast, you can take other types of liquids as well, like smoothies and fresh juices, but you just don't eat any meat. You don't eat any bread. You don't eat anything that's heavier than liquid. There's another fast that's called the partial fast. Partial fast is you determine and you decide beforehand what it is you're not going to eat and what you will eat. Some people say, I'm doing a partial fast, so I'm not eating any desserts for the next month. Anybody ever heard anybody fast? Like, yeah, yeah. But I'm going to stock up on hamburgers and hot dogs and all that, but I'm going to leave that sweet alone, right? That's called a partial fast. You have decided what you were going to give up. And if it's not something that you didn't want, now don't say I'm fasting on spinach. You know, it's got to be something that you really like and want. And then there's something that's called a corporate fast. Josh, do you have that slide? Corporate fast is what we do on Thursdays. We do a corporate fast. So what is a corporate fast? A corporate fast is done together as a church or a group with a specific purpose or goal for a set period of time. Our fast on Thursdays from 6 to 6, or as long as you can go within that 12-hour window. So corporate fast, what are we fasting for if we're fasting corporately as a church? the corporate fast here, we fast for Unity Christian Church. We fast for each one of you, each one of us, everybody who's involved with UCC. We fast for our youth and the education systems. We fast for our nation, state, and communities. We fast for those in leadership position. Oh, God. Please, we fast for those who are in leadership position, that the Spirit of the Lord will override and overshadow some decisions and activities and things that should not be. We're fasting for our families. And then whatever those other personal areas that the Holy Spirit gives to you, fast on that day while everybody is fasting corporately. Amen? So those are the areas, those are the broad areas that the Holy Spirit is going to give you specific areas of intercession within each one of those. But as long as we're fasting on the same day that UCC is fasting, that's called a corporate fast. Amen? And then there's something that's called a consecration fast. Amen. It's when you want to dedicate something to God. You may be rededicating your own life, consecrating your spiritual walk. But remember, fasting is not about the type of fast or the length of time we fast, but it's about drawing closer to God and doing His will. That's the statement. Fasting is not about the type of fast or the length of time we fast, but rather about drawing closer to God and doing His will. All right, everybody with me? All right, so now let's take a quick look at what was Isaiah talking about here. When the people were saying in Isaiah chapter 58, beginning with verse 3, the people said, God, why have we fasted and you do not see? They asked a question. Anybody ever felt like you prayed? Anybody ever prayed for something and then it didn't happen? Anybody ever fasted and prayed for something and it didn't happen? Okay, what should we learn from that? Should we get upset with God and do like these people did when they came to, when they came to Isaiah and they said, talk to God. Why have we fasted and you don't see us, God? Why have we humbled ourselves and you do not notice? Behold, on the day of your fast, you find your desire and drive hard all your workers. What did God just say? Why are you saying that you're fasting? You're not changing how you're living. You're still doing the same evil things that you have always been doing. You just turned your plate over, but your life hadn't changed. You didn't ask me to give you the strength to turn and to fast away from activities and things that you should not be doing. You're going through the motion, but you're not actually giving me your heart. Verse 4, behold, you fast for contention and strife and to strike with a wicked fist. God, I'm fasting that you allow me to beat those folk over there because I don't like them. I want you to take them down. I want you to kill them, God. Get rid of them. I'm fasting, God. Don't you hear me? Those people don't like me, so I don't like them. Anybody ever, amen, had one of those thoughts that come flying through your mind? Get them, God. Some people take it to another level. If I just fast and pray, God said, that's not the type of fast that is pleasing, that I want you to do. You do not fast like you do. God said, you don't fast like you're doing today and make your voice heard on high. See, people were trying to do the same thing that Jesus was talking to the Pharisees about. They want to be lifted up on high and just fast in a way to make themselves super spiritual. Verse 5, is it a fast like this which I choose? Now, God said, I want to tell you something here. I want you to have a day for a man to humble himself. Fasting is about humbling yourself. It's about coming before God as humble as you say, God, I'm turning over everything. God, I don't want nothing to hinder because I know I can't control nothing, but you control everything. So, Father, please hear me today. Please give me, God, the insight into what you are doing. See, one thing is, God, these are my petitions. This is what's going on. But now, Father, I need you to show me how to deal with the things that I'm concerned about. What did Habakkuk say? Amen. I'm coming back to that, Josh. I'm sorry. You don't even have to go with me. But Habakkuk asked the same question that we asked. Habakkuk 1:13. He said, your eyes are too pure to approve evil. God, I know you don't like wrongdoing. And you cannot look on wickedness with favor. So why do you look with favor on those who deal treacherously? Why are you silent when the wicked swallow up those more righteous than they? Anybody ever looked around and say, why are these evil folks getting over? Why is it that they're not getting what I know they should be getting? God, why are you just sitting there looking at them when they're, amen, taking good folks and much better than they are and just stepping on them, abusing them, robbing them, killing them, assaulting them? God, what's going on here? But then look at what Habakkuk said in 2:1. He said, I will stand on my guard post and station myself on the rampart. He said, okay, God, I ask you the question. I was speaking a little bit out of frustration because I'm looking around and I see a lot of stuff. So now I'm going to stand here and be quiet. And I will keep watch to see what he will speak to me and how I may reply when I am reproved. Oh, my God. We go up there all big. Lord, I'm fasting. I'm a faster. And now why I want you to make those folks over there behave. Tired of looking at them acting up. Well, God, I really don't know what you're doing. Maybe you're just giving them a little bit more rope and then they're going to turn around and have a testimony to tell somebody how not to live like they live. I don't know that, and my mind is not concerned about them right now. I'm just concerned about what I'm seeing. But God, if you want to put me and straighten me out, let me just sit here and listen to what you have to say. That's what Habakkuk was basically saying. And that's the same attitude and spirit that we have to have. Because again, I'm cutting this out right now. The reason for the fast is so that we can obtain and line ourselves up in a way that's going to glorify God with our lives. And the only way we can glorify God through our living is to, amen, obey and follow the direction of God. And the only way we can follow that is to remove the fleshly heart and to have it replaced with a heart of God. Let the Spirit of God take full control in our life. So why in the world would we not use the weapon that God has given to us? God said, when you're really fighting big demons, this kind come out only by prayer and fasting. When you're fighting something big, you got to show that spirit that's coming against you that you are serious. And that means humbling all that you are and trusting God in the strength and the power of God to override and overcome everything that Satan is trying to throw at you. You can't do it, but God can. And when you come to God and say, Lord, I realize no matter how much food I eat, I won't be strong enough to fight that demon. So I'm going to take this little temporary stuff, put it to the side where I can focus on you, where I can pray to you. And the time I would have been eating, I'm going to spend it in prayer. The time I would have been standing in line, giving them my order, I'm going to be standing, amen, sitting in my prayer closet and talking to you. Father, I'm at a point where I realize that I need you. And if you desire, see, Jesus didn't say, if you pray. He said, if you fast. He said, when you fast. Jesus said, when you fast. So if we are not fasting, that means we are not doing what Jesus expected us to do. And so as we bring this to a conclusion here, fasting points us to the cross. All right. Jesus denied himself. When we deny ourselves a little thing, we look at what Jesus denied himself of his glory. He came down, took on a form, allowed a man, sinful man, to misuse and abuse him. He gave up his very life. We want to give up something for the kingdom of God that's going to help to sustain us in our life. Jesus gave up his life in obedience to the Father to establish the kingdom of God for the salvation of all mankind. See, we want to walk into it, but Jesus did it already for us. It's already been established. He fasted to identify with God's people. He didn't have to fast, but he showed us how. He gave us a roadmap. He gave us a method of how to grow in God, how to connect with God. When he fasted, he and his Father, there was no separation. There was no room. There were no gaps in there for anything to get into. Jesus said, when you want to hear directly from my Father, remove things out of the way, and then you will have a straight line. Fasting is not a hunger strike. Fasting will make your spiritual ears open to hear better from our God. So what is God saying to you? Come on, Brother John, I'm finished. We're not going no higher than that. What is God saying to you? What are you seeking and believing and crying out to God for? Things that seems like there are no answers. We fast for strength. We fast for God's guidance. We fast to express our love and trust and worship for God. So whenever you have the opportunity to fast, see it as a sign of worship. See it as a sign of growing as you yield your vessel before God and ask Him to impart His Spirit more into us. But the only way that you can really have the Spirit of God, you got to have Jesus in your life. If you're not saved, if you've not given your heart to the Lord, then you won't have the strength to be victorious against what Satan is going to be bringing. But with God, all things are possible. So if you're not saved and you desire to give your life to the Lord right now, if you're viewing, just humble your heart, lift your hands. If you're in the house right now and you're not saved and you desire to give your life to the Lord this day, well, stand right where you are, all eyes closed, heads bowed. And we're going to pray this prayer right now of salvation and repentance. And if you mean the words of the prayer that you're about to pray and receive it and mean it from your heart now, you are and will be saved. Just say, Lord Jesus, please forgive me for all of my sins. Whatever is wrong, I will no longer do. Whatever is right, that will I do. I thank you, Jesus, for dying for me. I thank you, Jesus, for being resurrected for me. So that whenever I do come up a little short in my walk, and I pray and repent in your name, I know that I am forgiven. So come into my heart now. Be my Lord and my Savior. I thank you for saving me, for I am saved. In Jesus' name. Father God, we thank you today for the reminder that you've given us that you have already made it possible for us to grow in you, to remove the hindrances and the things that try to keep us locked down and locked in and not able to go to places where you already prepared for us to go. Help us to have the insight and the strength to be able to follow where you lead. Show us, Lord, how to fast, when to fast, what type of fast. But whatever we do, let us do it for your glory. And now as we prepare to commune with you, we thank you, oh God, for giving up your body and shedding of the blood. We thank you that we would not even have access to the kingdom right now if it had not been for you. So as we prepare to commune with you, oh Lord, we give you all that we are afresh. And for those who are viewing this live stream, whatever items that they're going to use us to commune along with us, be it cracker, bread, water, juice, we pray, oh God, that you would touch. Prepare those sacraments to be representative of your body and your blood. Just as we pray that you touch these sacraments here afresh. And each one of us, oh God, who's going to partake right now of this communion, we pray that you would forgive us of anything that would cause us not to be able or not to be partakers of your table. Any sins of omission or commission, we ask you and thank you for forgiving us right now. And now you made us whole and well all over again. And we give you the honor, the glory, and the praise. In Jesus' name we pray as we prepare now to commune with you. Amen. Amen. I'm going to ask Deacon Raymond, Deacon Andrew, if you would come at this time and to pass out the communion to all of the people of the Lord who desire to take communion at this time. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord.
Of Jesus.
Yes. Thank you for the blood, oh God.
Oh, the blood. Of Jesus.
Oh, the blood. Yes.
It washes
white as snow. Come on, let's say it together. Come on, somebody say, oh,
the blood of Jesus.
Oh, the blood. Reflect all over again where you would be if it had not been for the Lord. Where would we be if Jesus had not given of his life for each one of us? We would still be chasing after doves and lambs, trying to put a sacrifice in our place. But thank be to God. The same night that the Lord Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread, he broke it. He said, "This is my body that is broken for you. Eat ye all of it." After the same manner, when he had supped, he took the cup. He said, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood. Drink you all of it. You have done the will of the Lord," and whereby we are so thankful for the body and the blood of Jesus. Amen.
I know it was the blood.
I know it was the blood.
I know it was the blood for me. One day when I was lost, he died on the cross, and I know it was the blood for me.
Glory. presence through the blood and the body of Jesus Christ. And Father, you want us to grow, so we thank you that the tool, the method that you've given us, not only do we commune, but Father, we fast and we pray, and we know that the more that we trust you, the more higher we will go in you. So now, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your people. We thank you for your word. We thank you for knowledge, wisdom, and understanding. And now may the grace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide his both now and forevermore. We go in peace and we sin no more. God bless you. You are dismissed in Jesus' name. Thank you. Tune in next week. God bless you.
Jesus.